Okay, so good morning, everyone. So we can get started. So in the last class, we discussed about crawling and we discussed the different strategies and probably the guidelines that we need to consider in mind while doing the crawling. Okay, so quick recap. Yeah, so we discussed about web crawling, near duplicate, we'll be doing today. So we start with basically some kind of seed URL. You fetch and probably parse them and extract probably the text for indexing and URLs which can be further added to the URL frontier. And from there, you keep getting new URLs and process them. So it's kind of recursive process that we follow. So this is the visualization for the same. So you have seed URL, then probably URL frontier you extract. And in this way, you can basically explore the unseen web and get the relevant all possible URLs and try to remove the duplicate one. So we have discussed some complication and the issues, like you may encounter some kind of spam pages, spider traps that you need to take care of. Then we discussed about like any crawler should have kind of some must do features, must do guideline. So first is the robustness and second is the politeness. So we discussed that in politeness, there are two kinds of politeness, implicit and explicit. In explicit politeness, what we have discussed that is something explicitly mentioned by the web developer or probably the webmaster of these URLs, what parts of the website can be crawled, who can crawl and what is not. So kind of explicitly mentioned this. So as a ethical or probably as a web crawler, you need to keep that restriction in mind. Second, we discussed about implicit politeness, like even with no specification, but just to not create a service outage issue for the website, you should basically avoid hitting any site too frequent or too often. So what is too often? That is something you need to determine. Like you need to put some slip between two consecutive requests for the given website. So we discuss about the robot.txt. So we discuss about like its guideline and so. So we discuss like for a server, you can create a file robot.txt and basically it mentioned the access restriction. So like in this case, for all user agent, you are disallowing like this particular part of the website, you do not want anyone to crawl. And in this case, like all the search engine, you are allowing to probably access everything. So this is something you need to explicitly mention in the robot.txt. So that is about the must do feature for crawler. So now regarding the should do, I mean, it's good to have. So one is the distributed operation, because since you want to have the rate at which you want to crawl the pages should be quite high so that you can cover or probably access all these possible pages in less amount of time. And the second thing we discuss about the scalable feature. So your crawl should be scalable in such a way by adding more machine, it should be able to crawl the pages. The next should do feature that we have discussed, like performance and efficiency, because this is something you want to achieve without basically wasting the resources that you have. So the whatever the resources you have, you want to fully utilize it, but still you need to stick with whatever the must do and the should do feature we discussed. So kind of permit full use of available processing and the network resources. Next thing we discuss about the fetch pages of higher quality first. Differently, I mean, you want to give the high quality results to the user for their given query. And this you can only do once you have the quality pages in your database. So that's why fetch pages of high quality first. And continuous operation, like continuous fetching the fresh copies of the previous page. So it depends on application, depends on the area. So for example, we discussed like in case of news agency for the news pages, we need to continuously or probably very frequently get the fresh pages for a given website as compared to probably Wikipedia, which is not very frequently get updated. So extensible, like it should be adapt to the new data format, new protocols and so on. So by the way, which protocol do we follow to get the pages? Anyone?
Sir, HTTP.
Yeah, so the HTTP one, I mean, we follow and get the pages. So this is the updated crawling feature. So as we mentioned, like now you want to have not only one web crawler, but it's a distributed and you want to process in such a way that you can have distributed machines and different machines basically crawl the possible pages. Like in this case, you have different crawling thread, which continuously probably the parse the seed pages that you have and get the new URLs added to URL frontier. And from the URL frontier, you can keep getting the probably additional pages. So one thing you need to keep in mind, so as we have discussed in last class, so URL, while adding the new URL to the URL frontier, we need to keep few things in mind. Like you don't want to add the duplicate pages here. You don't want to add duplicate URLs here, because nearly 40 to 50% of the web pages nearly 40 to 50% pages, websites are kind of duplicates in some way. So we don't want to waste our resources in just getting the duplicate pages and probably parsing them, pre-processing them and so on. So we discuss about URL frontier. So that include like multiple pages from the same host. You must try to fetch all of them at the same time. So must try to keep all crawler thread busy. So this is something we are willing. So here URL frontier. So you need to keep all the crawler thread busy, but at the same time, you want to try to fetch all of them at the same time so that you can enforce the politeness and probably some of the must do and the should do features, behaviors. So while processing steps in the crawling, as we have discussed, so you need to pick a URL from the frontier, and which one? So there would be some criteria, you can say the priority that you need to keep in mind. Based on those priority, you can select the URL, fetch the document at the URL, parse the URL, and you can, after the parsing, you can get probably the media, you can get the text, you can get the URLs. So text is something which will be used for indexing the pages, and probably the URLs will be used for adding further to the queue that you have. So, and while before adding, you need to check if the URL has content already seen. If not, then you need to add to indexes. Otherwise, just ignore or probably discard it. So for each extracted URL, ensure it passes the certain URL filter that we discussed. Like, so for example, you're only looking for .edu pages. You're only looking for .in pages or .com, whatever. And in addition to that, it should also obey the robot.txt explicit filter, the criteria which are mentioned there. So check if it already in the frontier, duplicate URL elimination. This is something we need to keep in mind while doing the crawling. So this is the basic crawl architecture we have discussed. So you have basically the URL frontier, you have the basically you get the pages, and probably before getting the pages, you need to use DNS to resolve, get the IP address of the host server. And after resolving, you can get the page, you can parse it, you can basically see whether the content is seen before or not. If it is duplicate, then ignore. If not, then probably add to URL filter, and probably you can also do the robots filter. And you can also basically check if it's a duplicate URL element or not. If it is so, then eliminate. And finally, after doing all those, you can add the URL to the URL frontier. So as we have discussed, it will keep going, it will keep following the recursive process that we have in order to get the quality pages, in order to get the new pages and so on. So we discuss about DNS as well. So it's kind of a lookup service on the internet. So given a URL, it retrieves its IP address. And so as we have discussed, this might be the slow. So some of the solution we discussed, like one way you can do is like DNS caching. Another thing, what you can do, you can use the batch DNS resolver. So that collects the requests and send them out together so that the time spent in probably sending and looking up the latency will be reduced. So we have also discussed about the URL normalization, because when you are extracting or probably the parsing different pages, you may come to probably some relative links. So for example, /wiki/Wikipedia general disclaimer. So basically here, this particular link is referring to this one, and basically it's based add on to the base URL. So you need to create, you need to do the normalization to get all those links. So, so during the parsing, you need to must normalize, expand such relative URLs. So apart from this URL normalization, can you think of other normalization that you need to do while crawling? Anyone? What other kind of normalization you can think of? Anyone? I hope you can hear me. Anyone? Venkatesh, would you like to give it a try?
So perhaps I'm not sure, but maybe shortening or URL shortening and other relevant, maybe if it's a big URL, we may want to shorten it. That could be one normalization criteria.
Okay, yeah, nice. Or vice versa, you can also think of, so often people use tiny URL, right? Or shortened URL shortener. So ideally these URL shortener are mapped to the actual these URLs, right?
Yes.
And once you have the actual URL, then probably you can look for its IP address and so on. Very nice. Anything else, anyone? So thanks, Venkatesh. It's a nice example.
Sir?
Yeah, Niskash.
So for the tiny URL thing, won't it go till the stage of finding if the page is, if the URL is duplicate and then eliminating it, or will it be in the normalization process?
I mean, you can think it so. Definitely, I mean, we need to. I mean, as part of duplicate URL, you need to do. So if, and in fact, if there is any short URL. Right. So before you give it to the duplicate URL eliminator, it need to probably get the actual URL. Right. So as part, if you already do the normalization, because how you are going to check whether the page is whether the URL is duplicate. Right. So as mainly at the URL eliminator, if you see, let me go back to the previous slide. So here basically when perform the URL filter, we try to see the content as well. So here, I mean, even before the content, if you can find whether it's exact URL itself, right? If the URL is exactly the same as before, I mean, it is going to be the same page, right? It's good. Content is going to be the same. But here, I mean, as part of tiny URL, I mean, the URL is different itself, right? It is basically redirecting to some actual URL. So I believe that can be done as part of the normal. If you do this as part of the normalization, it will be relatively easier to handle during the, whether it's a duplicate URL or the content is same or different.
Got it, sir. Thanks.
Okay. So the content scene, so duplication is widespread on the web, as we have discussed, right? So nearly 40-50% pages are duplicate. So if these pages just fetch, kind of it's already, so in the index, so I mean, we do not need to further process it for several reasons, as we discussed. We don't want to waste our resources. We don't want to waste our time and so on. So this is verified using document fingerprints or the singless. So we'll be discussing singless in the second part of the lecture today. So fingerprinting, at least you can get an idea of what we're referring to. It's kind of create a fingerprint or some kind of hashing for the given page and try to match those with probably the new pages. If it is exactly matching, it means this might be the duplicate or probably nearly duplicate pages. So one issue with the fingerprints is, what do you think? Can fingerprint deal with the near duplicate pages as well, or only exactly the same or different pages?
Sir, what do fingerprints mean?
Sorry?
So, what do fingerprints mean in this context?
So, fingerprint, I mean, here mean that you create some kind of numbers, right? You create some kind of identifiers from a given document, a given page, right? So,
okay.
In that case, do you think the fingerprinting can also deal with near duplicate pages, or only the exact page if there is a match?
Sir, if we are associating some identifier, then only when the identifier is matched, then only, it is supposed to be a same page. So near duplicates will not have the such thing.
Yeah.
Because they will be having some different identifier.
Exactly. So I believe that fingerprinting can mainly helpful when you want to find whether it's the exact copy of the page, right? It's kind of exact duplicate.
So can we assume a checksum as a document fingerprint?
Kind of, yes, you are right.
Okay, sir.
So we need to find a ways to deal with near duplicate pages as well. So using the singless, I mean, that we'll be discussing today later slides, so that somehow deal with that. Okay, so we discuss about filters and robots. So that is you can also basically cache robot.txt in order to every time you do the filter and you can directly check with that.
So sometimes it happens that in URL when we click on some of the links, then it is associated with some data that is associated with that particular current page, and it redirects to some other page. But the thing is, the only difference is it is associated with some sort of form data into the URL as a get method. So are we also going to remove these sorts of data, like form data that is being sent to other page? Are we also going to remove in normalization phase?
So during the normalization, are you referring that the particular page is kind of referring to the same document or same page or?
Yes, sir. Sometimes it happens if there is a post and when we click on the comment, suppose there is a news feed and when we click on the comment, then only the page refreshes, but with some get data, some additional data associated with the form. And we are okay on the same page, but with some additional get data. Yeah.
Okay. So I believe you are referring to the dynamic content of the page, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So, this is not as part of normalization, right? In a way, because the URL remain the same, right? So only thing, that you need to do is get the data at the, because if something is dynamic in nature, right? You cannot keep the data with you. That is something need to be provided by the website owner itself, right?
Yes, sir. But it happens in the URL, data is encoded.
Sir, so I think what he's saying is, when we fire up a Google search, so with the URL now, the query string gets appended. So what he's saying is, when we try to normalize this, should we remove that with the page as well, or we should keep it? Like when you fire a GET query, the string gets appended to the domain name. That is what he is asking.
Yeah, got it. So I believe in that case, if it is a new URL, you can edit it, right? For example, suppose you have IIITED as a page, right? You already have. And over the time, you won't just save the IIITED.com, but probably you will also save IIITED/CSE/ probably something else, or probably the faculty, or whatever the different pages you have. So I believe, since these are the new page, new document, or kind of new content, I think you need to add.
Okay.
So duplicate URL elimination. So as we have discussed, for non-continuous or kind of one-shot call, so we need to see if an extracted or the filter URL has already passed to the frontier or not, right? So if it is already passed, so we need to process it accordingly, right? If the content, so as you were using the example, right? So despite the URL is already passed, but probably it's a dynamic page, or probably it may have some new content. In that case, you can add it to there. You can add it to the frontier. Or for example, as we have given the example, some pages need to be frequently crawled. So for example, news website, right? So the URL is same, but probably the content is kind of getting augmented or updated accordingly over the time. So in that case, you can add it. And basically, you can also determine the priority accordingly and pass it to URL frontier, and URL frontier accordingly deal with. So as we have discussed that we at the URL frontier, we are keep getting so many URLs, right? So many URLs from probably the different crawl threads we have. If you recall the previous architecture we have discussed, so you have multiple crawl threads. So under different process, you may have potentially a different nodes, and you can keep getting different URLs. Right? So in a way, you need to geographically distributed nodes, and you are basically getting the new URLs from the different distributed nodes that you have. So how do these nodes communicate and share URLs? So that is something you need to implement at the URL frontier. Okay, so this is the updated architecture you can think of, how the communication between the nodes happen. So, these are the previously same URLs as before. So basically, you have the pages, you have the DNS resolver, you fetch and parse the pages, and probably after parsing, you can see the content seen, documents that you have. You can perform the different filter that we have discussed, like you have the robots filter. And after that, so earlier you were having only the duplicate eliminator and pass to the probably URL frontier. Since now you have the distributed nodes, so you can put a kind of host splitter here. So this host splitter basically, based on the URLs, it divide the task into the different nodes that you have. Because firstly, you want to have the distributed crawling, because it is not feasible for only one crawl thread to probably process all possible web pages, right? In that case, probably you need to divide the task into the different crawl threads. And using this host splitter, you can divide the work into the different nodes. And now you can probably getting the new URLs after the parsing the web pages they have from different nodes. So you can basically having the different URLs from the different nodes, and you can run here the duplicate URL and probably eliminate the duplicate URL and add it to the URL frontier. So this is something this communication basically needs to happen here. So whenever you are getting all those new URLs, the host splitter basically the divide into the different nodes, and accordingly you can pass it to the new URL after eliminating the old URLs to the URL container. So URL frontier, so two main consideration we need to keep in mind. So one is the politeness, that is something we must have, right? If you recall, this is the must have feature. So it means that you do not hit a web server too frequently, right? So what is too frequently? That is something you need to determine. And second thing is the freshness, because some crawl pages are kind of more often than others. So as we have given the example, like news sites, so whose content changes very often. In that case, these pages need to be crawled frequently. But at the same time, you see, do you think, I mean, these two considerations are conflicting to each other?
So both ideas are contradictory to each other, right?
Exactly.
On one hand, we are saying ki, we shouldn't hit it too often. On the other hand, we are saying it should also be fresh enough.
Right.
Like we have to strike some sort of balance.
Exactly. And what this balance could be? How you can achieve this balance? Any guess?
So maybe we could devise some sort of criteria that let's say if in terms of time, maybe we could decide that in these many number of pages we could keep it fresh. Like let's say some page gets expired in these many days, so we'll just keep it fresh again.
Right. Okay, so yeah, we need to definitely we agreed that it is conflicting. Like these goals may be conflicting to each other. So a simple priority queue is fails, right? So many links out of a page to its own site, creating a kind of burst of access to that site. So that is something. So in that case, do you think, I mean, we should have some kind of more than one queues rather than only one priority queue? Or should we have probably two different kind of queues? So one probably focusing on the politeness, probably one focusing on the freshness or pro kind of priority. And you need to strike a balance using that. So let's see, probably with the example, I think in that case, it will be more clear. So in case of politeness, as we have discussed, like even if we restrict only one thread to fetch from a host, it can hit it repeatedly, right? So in a way, I mean, you are somehow enforcing politeness by, okay, so you have the distributed nodes. You are asking, okay, so only one node is now going to deal with one this host, but that particular thread can keep hitting that, right? So in that case, it means you need to have common heuristic is that you need to add some kind of time gap between the two successive requests, right? And this time gap could be in such a way that it respect the rate limit proposed by or probably the mentioned by these websites. Does anybody know what is the rate limit for the Google Search API? Have you used Google Search API?
Sir, I think close to 100. Because like when we try to crawl like after 100 requests, like even like Google Scholar, it basically blocks that IP for a certain number of
people. Is it per hour or what?
Sir, I think per second or something, 100 requests per second or something.
Okay. Yeah, so I mean, I also need to check the exact number, but yeah, at least you can find out by yourself. Yeah, so I mean, whatever that is the number, so you need to put a times, I mean, kind of sleep or probably some kind of gap here by putting a time like sleep this millisecond, such that I mean it respect the rate limit suggested by the websites. So here basically so this is Mercator scheme. So this is one of the very very popular paper. So it is based on one of the very popular paper. So this is how they have proposed the URL frontier. So what they have mentioned, we need to have the whenever you are having the URLs, you need to have a prioritizer. Using this prioritizer, basically you determine the priority of the URLs, and based on the priority. So for example, here you'll be having k front queues. So basically, they proposed this scheme mentioned that you need to have two queues, two type of queues. So one is the front queues, one is the back queues. What the front queues does, so front queues basically indicating the priority of the different URLs. So for example, in this case, whenever URLs are coming, prioritizer determines its priority on the scale of, for example, 1 to k. So based on the priority, you can put the particular URL into the corresponding queue. So for example, its priority is 1, you put into the Q1. And if its priority is say k, then it will put in the priority k. So once you have all those URLs in the different queues with the priority, you can basically bias from the queue selector, right? So in a way, because you want to probably have the URLs with the high priority first. And in this case, you can get the URLs with the high priority and now give it to the back queue router. So what back queue router does, so basically it has the B back queues and ensure that single host on one queue on each. And based on that, you can have the back queue selector and basically crowd the thing. So given that, can you tell me what front queue is doing, what back queue is doing? What is the responsibility of the back queue and what is the responsibility of the front queue? Anyone? So what you will achieve if we have this constraint like B back queues and such that single host on each.
Trying to parallelize.
Okay. Not exactly. Basically, if you see, I mean, we are putting a single host on each. It means, I mean, for one host, I mean, you only need to look at one queue. So you know that now this host is not distributed among different queues, so that you can try to implement the the politeness here. So for example, you are having here 1 to B queue. So once you have the B queues here, suppose we get one URL from probably first queue this, and since we know that now we have taken one URL from this particular queue and it has all the URLs from this particular host. If we go to the next, if we go to the some other queue, some other B queues, back queues, certainly it won't have the URL from this particular host. So in that case, you can implement the fairness, or you can say more about the politeness. Okay, so we are not going to frequently crawl or frequently hit that particular website. So let me go into probably more details, then probably it will be clear. So in a way, if you recall the previous slide, so the front queue basically manages the prioritization. And the second queue, that is the back queues that you have, that enforce the politeness. So each queue is kind of working the first in, first out, and basically you can. So this is the marketer schemes, marketer URL frontier schemes that we are referring. So this is one of the, as I said, one of the published paper in this area, and many crawler is kind of at least get inspired by this scheme. So this is the front queues I was referring to. So you have the prioritizer. Based on the URL's priority, you can put into the different queues. So like this queue having all the, this queue having the all URLs of priority 1. So this queue having the all URLs of priority 2 and so on. So similarly, this having the all URLs of priority k. So a biased front queue selector, basically what it does, I mean, given that, assume the priority, I mean, the lower the number, first the number is high priority. For example, 1 is greater than 2. In that case, what it will do? Where will this, it will get a URL and probably pass back to the back queue URL from which queue it will take? So given that the priority of this queue 1 is high, it will get a URL from this queue. And since it's first in, first out, you can probably get it. If you have the basically the I mean, some URLs in all the in all the basically the queues. If we keep getting the new URLs from the this queue, what will happen? In operating system, you
starvation.
Exactly. So starvation will happen, right? Because it might be the case this queue will never be empty, and the queues with less priority will get starved. In that case, how we can deal with this starvation problem? What are the techniques you have learned in OS?
We can go with round robin.
We can go with the round robin. Very nice. So if we can think of, okay, so since this is a priority one, so first we'll get from this and probably go to the priority two and so on. You can think of different variant of it as well. So for example, whenever a new URL is coming, right, you know their timestamp as well, right? So what you can do, you can implement the intersection of, or you can say you can implement both criteria at the same time, arrival time and the round robin fashion. So for example, there are three requests in the priority one came before any request probably come in this other low priority. Then probably rather than getting just one URL, you can get all three, because at that given time, these were the probably the top priority and there were no items in this list. So does it make sense? Yes. Similarly you can yes. Think of other variation and you can basically make it more robust and probably get it done. So in a way, prioritizer basically assigns a URL to a URL and integer priority between 1 to k and appends URL to the corresponding queue. And heuristic for assigning priority, refresh rate sample from the previous crawl, application specific, and probably what are the other heuristics you can think of? So one is the refresh rate, one is the application specific, like a news site and more. What could be other heuristic you can think of to determine the priority of the URL? Anyone? How you can determine the priority of a URL?
Based on its importance.
And based on?
Its importance, like how reputation, how reputed it is. Something. For example, like Wikipedia or any like tech journals.
Mm-hmm. Very nice. Very nice. Similarly, I mean, you can also think of, probably you can also think of recently add pages, or probably you can also think of I want to only focus on the pages in India, or probably something. So for example, it is election time. I want to give the more importance to any news which is coming during the election, right? Probably you can also think of, okay, so any news which is coming if the World Cup is going on, right? When you want to probably give any news which is talking about the World Cup. Something like that. I mean, there could be numerous other ways to assign priority. So as the bias front queue selector, so when a back queue requests a URL, so it picks a kind of front queue from which a URL to pull it. So it pulls the URL from the front queue and give back to the back queue. So this choice can be made in the round robin fashion, as we have discussed, right? So to the queues of higher priority or some sophisticated variant, and can be randomized as well. So this is something we have discussed just now. So these are the back queues you have. So you have the back queues like this is back queue one, back queue two, back queue B. So if you recall, we mentioned that we will implement this back queue in such a way that is only one host will be there on only one back queue, so that whenever you probably, again, so back queue selector select the URL, it will be in such a way that it will not get the URL of the same host probably more than once, so that it can implement the politeness feature. So in a way, the back queue invariant is like each back queue is kept non-empty while the crawl is in progress. Each back queue only contains URL from a single host. So in a way, you can maintain a table host to back queues mapping. And you can accordingly get the queues, they get the URL from the web queues and give it to the heap, and accordingly you can crawl it. So back queue heap basically one entry for each back queue, and the entry is earliest time TE at which the host correspond to the back queue can be hit again. So this kind of earliest time or kind of some kind of timestamp mechanism help you to determine, okay, so when you need to hit that particular URL again. So earliest time is determined from last access to that host, any time buffer heuristic we choose, or probably other criteria you can think. So regarding the back queue processing, so it's a kind of a crawl thread seeking a URL to the crawl. You extract the root of the heap because you know, I mean, that is the URL you need to get it now. So once you fetch the URL at the head corresponding to the back queue, look up the table and check if the queue is empty or not. If it is empty, then pull a URL V from the front queue and add it there. Because if you recall, we mentioned that you want to keep the back queue non-empty. If there is already a back queue for V's host, append V to the to it and pull another URL from the front queue and repeat it. Else otherwise just add V to the queue. So it's basically in this way we can queue is kind of back queue is non-empty and we can create a heap entry for it. And accordingly, you can simply every time whenever you have to get the new URL, simply look at the top of head of the queue that you have, and you can get the corresponding URL from there. So the number of debugs is B. So keep all thread busy while, because you want to have distributed crawling. So since different crawler or different thread is basically a different back queue having the different host. In that case, you can distributed way, you can assign different back queue to the different threads. And that ensure that the different threads won't probably access the same, hit the same host again at the same time, because there is only one host at one back queue. So this will be somehow ensure that the politeness will be at least at the host level will be there. So Mercator recommendation is that three times as many as back queues as crawler threads. Yes.
So in this architecture, like the demarcation between front queue and back queue is just for buffering, because like can't we calculate like the priority on the fly, like because front queue seems to be only like a placeholder, like a buffer, so that we can like pick the priority and put them in back.
So front one, I mean, definitely ensuring the priority, right? So so do you want to have the priority at the back front as well? Back queues as well?
Sir, I was just thinking like maybe instead of two queues, why can't we like just have one single like queue with priority computed on the fly, like, or like a priority queue? Like why do we have that demarcation? Is it like for buffering, like to decouple this, or like what was the reason behind this particular tiered architecture?
Okay, so anybody want to comment on that? I mean, so your question is indeed very interesting and very probably valid as well. Why do we need to have two queues rather than, if we can only have the front queues, right? Very interesting question. Anybody want to comment on that? What could be the reason?
So we were trying to strike out a balance, no?
Exactly. And secondly, I mean, if you go through this paper, Mercator, so basically they have mentioned that, I mean, why we need basically two kind of queues, right? Because if you only have these queues, I mean, this may not able to probably give you, because it might be the case that two URLs probably having the same priority, but that won't, and you add it to the probably the same priority queue, and once you are probably getting the URL from there, you may somehow breach the politeness in some way. So that's why probably you need the second queue as well which somehow ensure that. So here basically your task is mainly to focus on priority. Here the task is mainly to focus on the politeness, and in a way you can together maintain a kind of strike a balance between these two. And you can refer to this paper again. So they have explained probably in more details why these cues are helpful together. Okay.
Yes.
So the next part of the today's lecture is near duplicate document detection. How we can do so? So the web is full of duplicate content, strict duplicate detection, exact match, right? So not as common because you may not have mostly when we say the duplicate page is never mean that, I mean, you have the exact page often. You may have the exact page, but sometimes you see some website basically change very slightly. I mean, for example, they change the author, they change the probably just add one line and probably just copy paste probably the data from others. In fact, there are different companies. In fact, there are different companies whose task is to do so. Whose task is to do to, have you heard of something called SEO? Or SMO or something? Have you heard of this term, SEO?
Yes, sir.
What's that?
Search engine optimization.
And what they do?
They basically get your page ranked higher on a Google search or any search engine for that matter.
So they basically add some meta tags that contain some information about the pages as well, and some other information that is helpful in the searcher, the Google search, to rank the page more efficiently.
Exactly. And because they believe that, and in fact up to some extent it is true as well. They believe that if they increase the page rank of the page website, the hit will be probably more, and probably the Google will show that page on the top. So these companies and these executive basically the paid, if the some companies are probably the client's page, they are able to probably bring to the first page or probably the second page, which is probably earlier on the 10th page. And this is somehow they do. They create the duplicate content, they create the hyperlink, they do all those stuff. They cannot create all the new content always, right? So that's why they also create a lot of duplication and probably just create the hyperlink and all those stuff. So that's why we have duplicate pages and we need to determine and discard them. So for many cases of near duplicate, so last modified date or probably the only difference between the two copies of the page. So this is something you can also think of. So how we can, so because we discussed that using fingerprinting, using checksum, you can basically determine, okay, so if the two pages are exactly the same copy, but the problem arises, and in fact, such cases are not that much among the web is full of duplicate content. So majority of them are like this. So like last modified date, or probably slightly changed, or probably just create a hyperlink in the any existing website, make a copy and create a hyperlink, or probably just to probably increase the page rank of the different pages. So in a way, I mean, these are nearly duplicate pages and that we need to get rid of. So duplication, like exact match, can be detected with the fingerprinting. And for the near duplicate, we need to have some approximate matching. So our view is like computes syntactic similarity with an aided distance measure. And since these are not exact match, you need to have some kind of approximate match, like similarity is greater than 80%. Or similarity is greater than 90%. Something like these numbers you can have to determine if the pages are near duplicate or not. So in this way you can determine. So how you can determine this syntactic similarity between two pages?
We can represent them as vectors and to cosine similarity, or we can like represent them as set of k-grams and compute jacquards.
Exactly. So there are both are the possible ways. So as part of this approach, they mentioned something kind of k-gram that you're referring. So what they have done, they exactly done very, very same thing that you mentioned. So they mentioned that segment a document, a kind of different small singlets. The singlets is nothing but a kind of word of n-gram. So like in this case, if you have this sentence, like what are the 4 grams you can create? These are the four grams you can create. Like a rose is a rose. And finally, rose is a. And probably finally, last one is a rose is. In this way, you can get these possible 4 grams. And once you have for the different documents, once you get all those basically the possible singlets or probably the k grams, you can simply just compute. Okay, so how many such k grams are common among the two documents? And you can simply compute that using the Jaccard coefficient, right? Because it's kind of in, you want to find the commonality between the two sets of two sets, and the set having the elements like this, right? So what you can do, similarity measure between two documents will be the number of set of singlets, and that you can compute using Jaccard coefficient, like size of, and what is the Jaccard coefficient? Intersection divided by the union. So here you can have the size of intersection between the two documents divided by the size of union. It makes sense, right? And in this way, you can compute the similarity. So computing exact set interaction of the singlets between all pair of documents is expensive, right? Because you may have usually what k gram that you mentioned, right? Usually the document length is like 500 words, 2000 words, or probably even 5000 words, right? So in that case, you can, if you're going to have considered all such possible of singlets, I mean, it is going to be huge. It takes time, right? What you can do in order to expedite it? So you can basically approximate using a cleverly chosen subset of singlets, right? So what you do? Okay, so rather than going for all possible singlets, how about just, since we are doing approximation, how about we just get a subset of that? So in that case, you can have a sketch. How you can do? So basically, the sketch should be in such a way that is representative of the given document. So like you have document A, you determine all singlets set A, and you can determine the sketch of A, and similarly you can get the sketch B. So now rather than computing the similarity with all possible singlets, you can basically just estimate the same for the two short sketches. And in this way, you can compute the Jaccard coefficient, and based on the Jaccard similarity, you can mention that whether it's a near duplicate or not. So like in this case, you can see you create a sketch vector of size, so say 200 for each document, and documents that share say greater than t, 80% or 90% corresponding vector are deemed as a near duplicate. So in this way, you can do so. So for document D, such IS follows, like you try to possible all such possible universe of singlets, and you can do the fingerprinting. So you can simply get some random permutation of all these possible singlets and see whether how many of them are matching or not. So it's kind of something similar you are willing to achieve here. And it might be the case for a given document A, if you get the sketch A, similarly given the document B, you get the sketch B. For one sketch, it may be the possibility that it matches, right? But if you want to make it more robust, what you can do in that case? In order to make it more robust, what else you can do here? Any guess? Why do you do n-gram? I'm not n-gram. Why do you do the cross validation? Anyone?
To reduce variance.
To reduce the variance, or probably make sure the result that you have is the robust enough, right? So the similar thing can you do here? So for example, for a given document A and similar set A, you can
pick multiple subsets.
Exactly. So you need to repeat this process for say a number of times. So this exactly I'm referring here. So what you need to do, you can randomly permutate, do the permutation for this, And you can do this for a minimum number of time over all single SMS. So for example, in this case, you can think of, I mean, we do for 200 times, right? So for given document A, given document B, you can do the permutation. And based on this permutation, every time you just do the matching. So like this document one, document two, this is the maximum possible number of singles that you have. And just select some random permutation, and based on, for example, 200 random permutation, you can compute the similarity, for example, 200 times for the selected sketch, like sketch pi 1, sketch pi 2, and sketch pi 200, and take probably the average of whatever you can do. So the average of all these is probably greater than the threshold that you have. It means these documents are nearly duplicate. And again, basically, you can determine this. So A and B, like if and only if the singles with the minimum value in the union of document one to common in both. So in this way, you can compute again similar numbers to determine if they are same. So set of like similarity of, so in this case, as you know, the Jaccard coefficient is the number of intersection divided by the number of union. Something similar you can compute here. So like here you have these, you can compute the Jaccard coefficient here. So like intersection is 1 and 2, and union is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So Jaccard coefficient comes to be 2 by 5. So these are, I mean, additional things you can check. So if you have a number of rules of type A, type B, and accordingly you can modify the Jaccard coefficient. So similar thing you can do for minimum hashing. So you can randomly permute rows, determine the hashes, and accordingly you can determine this. So I skip this part since we need to do the presentation, but it's overall the similar idea. Where basically you do some random permutation, you try to approximate the similarity between the two documents. As we mentioned that computing this over the all possible subset is probably very time consuming. So in that case, you can further reduce it by considering the sketches, numbers, smaller sketches, and so on. And in this case, you can determine. So the final note is like, singleness is a kind of randomized algorithm. Our analysis did not presume any probability model on the inputs. It will be give us the right or wrong answer with the same probability of any. And in this way, in life, we will have to concurrently look at many pairs. So in the book, it is provided into more details. You can read. So with this note, we can end here. If you have any question, let me know.
So whatever part is skipped in the class, is it a part of our syllabus otherwise for the NSEMs?
I mean, mostly, I mean, so for example, in the previous lecture, we discuss about page rank, and probably the second part we left it, right? So, I mean, we will be only covering the part which is covered. So similarly, in some of the lectures, you can think of, I mean, whatever the part is covered is going to be the part of syllabus.
Like, I think one lecture related to D-trees was also left, like the whole lecture slides were left in class.
Mm-hmm.
But like in the quiz, it was asked, so that's what I was asking.
Okay, then probably I will check with the TAs, at least in the NSEM, we'll make sure that only the content which is covered in the class will be there. Okay. Okay, so who will be presenting today?
Group number 33.
Should I make you co-host?
No, Pragyapal. Make the co-host to Pragyapal.
Okay, so I make...
Pragya, you are here? Hello?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, Pragya, I made you co-host. You can share your screen. Who is the next group?
So group 20.
Can you... Tejas, should I make
Tejas.
You...
And... Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, so Tejas, I made you co-host. Who want to go next? Who is third group?
Sir, group number
30.
So Anshu, should I make you co-host?
No, sir.
No, Vibhor.
Vibhor, yeah, Vibhor.
Okay, Vibhor, I made you co-host. Please go ahead, everyone. Thank you so much. So recall my last video. Please don't go beyond 10 minutes. Thank you so much. Please go ahead.
Able to see my screen, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. We are group number 33. And today we are going to propose a system which will basically help or assist the farmers in taking care of their crops or plants. So it is crop assistance system. So basically this system will definitely revolutionize the agriculture, and we are trying to do this with the help of some information retrieval techniques. What are the driving forces which basically motivated us to propose this system? Over the past few years, the Indian agriculture has witnessed loss in food crop productivity due to various reasons. Some of them we have mentioned here. First is lack of farming knowledge among the farmers. Second is environmental changes. Third is due to over and under fertilization. Sometimes crops are not able to survive. And sometimes due to over or under watering of plants also, it's become hard for the plants to survive. And sometimes due to delay in the watering. And basically, due to the scarcity of soil nutrients, sunlight, water, etc., in specific areas, plants suffer in surviving. Now I'll forward to Ram Babu. He will take carry forward from here.
Yeah, the major issue with the there is communication like between the farmers and plant. Since the plant are immobile, there is no proper way in which plant can directly communicate with the humans. Because of it, there is sudden environment change. Like during the drought, plant take several measures, such as they close their leaf to limit the water resources. Next. And in some other cases, like some threat from the outside, some instant damage, plant cry for the help. Due to the lack of the adequate communication system, plant and human can help the plant communicate with the human and our farmers. Sometimes what will happen, there is a lack of knowledge with the farmers and plants. Humans or farmers add some error, like under fertilization, plant are not able to survive. Next. Atifil will explain the plant of communication.
Yeah. So now let's look how plants communicate via root signaling. So it has been established that the plants do communicate and respond to external stimuli through root signaling by generating vibrations or by secreting chemical substances. Next, please. So plants secrete inorganic ions and substances, amino acids, volatile or aromatic compounds, with the help of which they communicate with each other. Next. Internet of fungus is yet another method of communication in plants. So in this, the plants communicate with each other using an internet of fungus. For example, mushrooms are made up of mass of thin threads known as myceliums. So what they do is they kind of form an underground internet linking the roots of different plants, with the help of which they share nutrients and other informations by secreting chemicals into the network. Next. So our proposed system, next slide, please. So our proposed system consists of various components. Firstly, we have the sensors placed below the ground nearby the roots of the plants in order to sense the signals generated. Then this raw data collected by the sensors is sent to the servers, which is fed to the machine learning model for processing and pattern recognition. Then the machine learning model will predict the needs of the plants, and the farmers will be notified of the plant need through a text or a voice notification in their regional languages. Next, please. So what we are basically proposing is an innovative system that can sense the root vibrations and chemical secretions of the plant and can cater to their needs. Plants generate the communicative signals using volatile organic compounds, as discussed earlier. So this underground communication can be sensed with the help of the sensors of our proposed systems and can be collected for further processing and pattern recognition. So the proposed system will be able to detect the plant's requirement and notify the farmers. And now Dipankar will take forward from here.
Thank you, Atif. let's go through the methodology. Can we go to the next slide, please? Yeah. So basically, the methodology here involves all the points that have been said by my fellow teammates here. So first, we need to take the sensor readings. The readings will be basically an audio or a sound wave signal right from the root using these sensors, because as we have learned that the roots are actually communicating with each other. And then what we need to do is we need to label these signals carefully by observing the plant behavior under certain environmental conditions, like whether it needs more water, whether it's infected by some pesticides or harmful chemicals are not going well with its system, heat, something like that. We have mentioned two sensors here. One is the surface acoustic wave and QCM, which are well-known sensors for this. Now, after the wave signals are generated, what we do is we remove the noise from it and we calculate MFCC. Now, this MFCC is a very important feature extraction part in the process, which is traditionally followed by many other systems, which deals with speech to text, text to speech. And then we match these signals with the hidden Markov model, HMM, which has been taken from one of our research reference papers. Can we go to the next slide, please? Yeah. So now the interesting part is the output text which is generated is now fed into a sec-to-sec model. So where is this output text coming from? So we captured the signal right from the root using these sensors. Then we passed it on to a speech-to-text converter that is generating this text, and that is again forwarded to a sequence-to-sequence model. Now, why do we do this? We do this because we want these texts to be available in multiple other languages. Our targeted user is the farmer. So that's why we do this. Like I mentioned, like Hindi, Punjabi, or any colloquial language. Now, once the sec-to-sec model produces an output, we use the text-to-speech conversion technique to create speech out of it. Traditionally, we can also use the Google text-to-speech conversion that is readily available in the market. Can we go to the next slide, please? Yeah, so this is a high level proposed architecture from our side, where you can see that there is a wave signal. After the removal of noise, it calculates the MFCC. HMM plays a very important role in speech to text conversion. Once the desired text output is there, it gets converted into some other colloquial text like Punjabi Hindi. For here, we took in an example of English where it is written machine learning is fun, and that gets converted into some other language, end of the sec to sec model. And then that is converted to text to speech. This is how we are establishing a kind of interaction between a plant and the human. I would request Shivam to take forward from here. Shivam, can you please?
Thank you, Dipankar. So talking about the existing research, we have found some research paper. Existing research has been conducted in which the plants sense the motion of the human present near them. And also the Hello. Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Existing research has been conducted in which plants can sense the motion of the human present near them and also the stimuli of the plant during the infection by the pesticide and have captured in one of our researches. But they do not have any interaction between human and plants. And Google is also working on the idea of Google Tulip, which focuses on human-plant interaction and planted a product. Even if such product exists, it will only be focused on tulip. But we are focusing more towards the farmers and their agricultural crops. Next slide, please. So now, after knowing about the methodology and the existing research, now let's move on to some challenges that we think we might face going forward. Since the topic is fairly new, we don't have any prior data set to help our project or to take any reference from any data set. So one of our major challenges will be collecting data. Now, as we are dependent on different sensors to build our data set, select a particular and the right sensor is one of very challenging also. The next problem is interpreting the data. To classify the data set according to our needs and is also a bit of a challenge. As we know that from the methodology, that the hidden Markov model takes the classified data to train our model. Diversification of the data set, as many plants may react differently the same stimulus. So diversifying the data set is also a very challenging. Next slide, please. Now, knowing about the novelty of the proposed system, as our idea is fairly new, there are no commercially deployed systems in the market that can allow a conversation between humans and plants. Our main focus will be towards helping the farmers taking good care of their products and plants. There have been few experiments towards motion sensor and infection detection, but their purpose were entirely different. We want to use the data for conveying the thought of the plants to the humans, and it will be a major breakthrough towards plants and human interaction. Next slide, please. Now talking about the feasibility. Now we have divided our feasibility into three terms: short term, mid term, and long term. In our short term, that consists of 1 to 2 years, we are thinking of building a data set, and we are thinking of solidifying our sensor needs. So we will be doing, take a few sets of sensors and build a data set and a data mining and data mining system. And after that, we are planning to create a prototype capable of understanding and communicating to humans about the basic stimulus, like more water, less water, heat, or etc. In the midterm, we are planning to have a solution that would now be a full-fledged product that can be commercially used by different farmers also. The product will have more features and would have the capability of interacting better with humans. Now, in the last long term, we are getting a bit ambitious. So we want to have a product that can have a two-way communication between plants and humans. They will be able to have a complete interaction with the farmers also. This would possibly be the more will advance more powerful AI. We have taken our references from these two papers. Thank you. Any question?
Okay, so thank you so much, everyone. Very nice presentation. Since we are running out of time, so please answer Shivang's question in the chat. And next group, please share the screen.
So can we go ahead, sir?
Yeah, anyone here.
Okay, is my screen visible?
Yeah. So please wrap up in 10 minutes. Thanks.
Sure. Should we reply them in the chat? So, once again, sorry. So, good morning, everybody. My name is Bhor Kumar, and we are going to, me and my friends, going to present our proposed app that is COVID Counselor Smart Advisor. So we all know that we are facing a deadly pandemic and we are required to isolate ourselves to deal with the pandemic. And that's what the situation demands. But this isolation, not being able to meet our friends or not being able to socialize might also lead to some mental health issues. And moreover, not being able to socialize isn't the only problem, but many have faced social discrimination because of the virus and that led to suicide. So according to the report published by The Wire, there has been an increase of 67% in the suicidal cases or behavior in the span of this 1.5 years and especially during the lockdowns. And if you try to get into the minds of a suicidal person or a person who is going through some tough times, the most common thing that they usually find themselves is in the some sort of difficult situation or some sort of shell they are not able to get out of. So during our research, we came across few cases shared by NCBI, be it Santosh Kumar who committed suicide or Emily Owens or the Chinese student from UAE who committed suicide. The most common thing we discussed is they felt they are stuck at some kind of situation. So the only way to get out of this is suicide, but there can be many solutions we believe they are just not able to figure out. So we propose a mobile application which assists users in more specific way and personalized way using the machine learning and information retrieval. So the purpose of this mobile application is get into the minds of a person who is going through tough times and give him some kind of assistance to get out of that particular shell. So after that, Anupam will take over.
Okay, next slide.
Yeah.
As you mentioned by before, we are basically proposing a mobile-based application which will contain features like questionnaires, self-assessment, and chatbot. Next slide. Next slide. The question is the most important part of our application, as it will help us to know the state of mind of the user. The questions in the questions will be prepared under the guidance of the professional psychiatrist. We will also assign some weightage to the questions, as same questions can occur in different situations but have different amount of effect on the user. So we will accordingly weight the questions according to the specific situations. Next slide. In the self-assessment part, we will try to find out the current sentiment of the user, like whether he is feeling happy, sad, or angry. These sentiments will be known by the answers provided by the user to some specific questions. No, next slide. Yeah. Knowing the specific questions, it will help us to assist the user in a more specific way, because the more we know the user, the better our application will perform. Now, both of these features like self-assessment and questionnaires will help our chatbot interact with the user during the interact with the user. And that will be further described by the Anshu.
So before explaining our proposed chatbot system, I would like to first tell you about the existing systems that are present right now. So while proposing our system, we analyzed all the existing chatbots that are currently available right now. So what we found is most of them are either simple chatbots, like patient to doctor, doctor kind of interaction, where users have to pay some amount like $150 per month or so. It may vary, which is really expensive considering this COVID time. So also we found some of the AI based chatbot systems, but their performance.
I'm so sorry, I cannot hear you.
So I think you're not audible.
Yeah, so, okay, so anyone else from the group want to take
over? So in the existing system, what we did, what we experimented with few existing existing chatbot assistance app. So what we found out that they kind of were giving some sort of generalized answers, like they did, like if I say I lost my job, then I'm expecting from my app that we are proposing is he will give some kind of advice to stay part of the home and look for a job, or give some kind of addresses of all those companies that have vacancies. But in the existing applications, they are just giving up some sort of generalized answer, like I'm getting you, or I hear you, or like I get this, and keep going. So these are the things that we do not expect. So yeah, so chatbot architecture will be explained by Divyang.
Hello everyone, this is our chatbot architecture. First of all, when user enters the message, it will be given to the natural language processing engine. It will do mainly two tasks, intent classification and entity extraction. Intent is the target of user input. It is the verb in your all dialogue. The action user wants to take that they expect chatbot to take or facilitate. Entity is the useful information can be extracted from user input. It indicates object on which action should be performed. For instance, entity is noun in our dialogue. For example, if I say I lost my job, then this lost is our intent and job is our entity. After the intent and entity extraction, the dialog manager will decide which action to perform next using user specific information, previous interaction and current message. Our chatbot will use machine learning algorithms like RNN and LSTM. This algorithm is useful when your next output depends on series of previous inputs. Feedback and retrain mechanism will adjust our model weights according to user feedback. And at last, the message generator will generate the message and send it to the user. It will use predefined templates and placeholders. Next portion will be introduced by Shivam.
Okay. Thank you, Divyan. Please change over the slide. Okay, so this slide talks about the novelty of COVID Counselor, and they are as follow. Firstly, analyzing the user state of mind. COVID Counselor assigns the weight to the answer given by the user to chatbot during self-assessment, and it generates a score and classifies the state of user's mind accordingly. Secondly, user-specific solutions. The existing chatbot was not annotating the user query to the point. For example, consider a query which says that, I am fat, what should I do now? Then chatbot will suggest him possible solutions, like go for a gym, for instance. Then comes smart assistant with reliable suggestions. It smartly suggests answer to user by analyzing his way of talking and reading the mental states of mind. And lastly, precisely identifying the various mental health issues. It is the ability to figure out different mental issues like depression, breakup, etc. Next slide, please. Okay, so the next slide talks about the feasibility of the system. So our short-term feasibility includes expanding the range of varieties of questions and improve upon the accuracy of extraction and intent. And the midterm feasibility deals with the improvement on information retrieval side and improving the dialog manager to enhance the user interaction. And for long-term feasibility, multi-language support, providing real-time for help from professionals, providing support for all devices are included. So yeah, that's all for now. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you. In the interest of time, so next group, please share your presentation. Please answer the questions in the chat. Anmol, are you saying something? I cannot hear you.
Hello?
Yeah, I can hear you now. Please go ahead.
Okay. Hey, everyone. Good morning. This is group number 20 presenting a model on tweet context relevance analysis through hashtag. Next slide. So we all know that in recent times, more or less every organization, be it a political party or a startup or a company, they basically try to leverage their marketing through social media. And most popularly, their campaigns and everything around it goes on Twitter. The recent example is obviously the campaigning for various elections and the current ad by Cred as well. That's a great example how marketing revolves through and campaigning revolves around Twitter. Next slide, please. Mostly these campaigns suffer through a huge backlash and a problem and a risk to fail. How? Specifically because we know of a major problem like hashtag hijacking, in which the a tweet or a trend as expected by a campaign manager or a marketer gets out of hand, and it is like the effect is completely opposite, but the approach that he was trying to do with the take with the tweet, it just gets opposite. Next slide, please.
So the problem statement: the main aim of a system is to analyze the tweets and extract relevant information from the context by analyzing the text corpus and common spam attributes like user information and number of retweets, likes, etc. And we'll be analyzing some common hashtags using NLP and ML techniques. the motivation to build this system was the organizations who carry out a ad campaign can keep a check on the hashtags which are related to them so that the people do not use their hashtags for their personal agendas. Various hashtags and trends are used by social media companies to do marketing and to reach more people. But these hashtags are hijacked and ultimately result in harming their own motive. So the system can be used as an analytics tool by these companies to monitor their online campaigns and track the effectiveness of these hashtags.
Yeah, for example, once MACD came up with hashtag Mac Stories for positive marketing push, in which they ask Twitter audience to share their happy stories with MACD. But people instead came up with their negative experience with MACD, which was like counterproductive for their marketing strategies. Next slide. So once our model is implemented completely, we can propose some organization to aid them with their advertisement campaign as an analytics tool. Like these model may have helped companies like MACD to track hashtag use by their marketing team, and they could have check whether their campaign was going in planned direction or not. Next slide.
So the high-level architecture of the system would look like this. The user will supply input parameters, which would be hashtags of interest, which the user wants to monitor, the expected sentiment values that they want from the users. Like for in case of MACD Stories hashtag, the McDonald's company expected the users to tweet positive things about that. So they will say that the expected sentiment value will be positive. Then the time span for which they want the tweets to be analyzed, and the language in language or the language which they are targeting. For example, it could be English, and then the model will take these inputs from the user and will retrieve the relevant tweets using the Twitter API. And from these tweets, the model will do pre-processing, removal of punctuations, lemmatization, and all that. And after that, we will search for URLs, and the model will search for URLs in the tweets, and then for the URLs, we will see if they are spam, if they are spam URLs using the Google Safe Browsing API. And then after that, the model will use the user parameters and text corpus and feed them through three different models, which would be one model would evaluate the tweets based on FIDF scorings, and the other would be the account or tweet tweet attributes, which would basically give a confidence score to the user and will help in identifying whether the user is a bot or not, account is a bot or is a human. And then the third will be the sentiment analysis of the tweet. And then these three model outputs will be combined to create a cumulative score, which will be used to finally determine whether the tweet has been hijacked or not. Next slide. So the novelty added to the system, all the already existing systems or the already existing researches that have been done use either of these methods. They use context-based models, which do some classification, or use deep learning models. Some models use TF-IDF. Then there is user information-based prediction, which says if the model is bot or not. And then URL check for spam using systems, which deal with multiple hop URLs. But what we are proposing is a system which combines all these techniques and gives us a holistic view of the, gives us an entire picture of what is going on. Next. Now Shivani will talk about the feasibility of the system.
Yeah, Shivani will talk about the 5-year and 10-year feasibility. So in short-term feasibility, currently the main challenges of this model is requirement of manually annotated Twitter dataset. So in short-term feasibility, we would need to continuously feed more manually annotated dataset for better accuracy. Also, emotions like sarcasm, humor, mockery, and irony pose a problem for our model to classify, as these are subjective terms and vary from person to person. So we can extend our model to classify these type of tweets as well. Next slide.
visibility in 5 years. Currently, our model cannot predict whether a new hashtag is hijacked or not. So we will try to predict new hashtags which are not present in our training data set as well. URLs are computationally expensive to classify as they are usually made from URL shorteners like bit.ly, tinycc, etc. Moreover, the URLs hop on multiple redirections before reaching a final endpoint. Thus, crawling and classifying these is very expensive. With this proposed model, which primarily focuses on classification through user parameters and text corpus, so we will try to incorporate this feasibility in 10 years. This model can be used to detect fake news trending through hijack hashtags in long term. We can extend this model to classify posts on Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, etc. This model can be extended for classifying tweets in various other languages as well, like Spanish, Hindi, etc. Feel free to ask any questions.
So thank you, Shivani. And any questions, anyone? So what is the biggest challenge you can see here in the solution that you have?
So right now, okay, go on.
Yeah. So I think the biggest challenge is within a tweet, there are multiple retweets promoting a personal agenda for a given topic. So retrieving that entire thread and classifying whether it's a personal agenda or they're pushing in general public interest or general trend, that is the first thing, because that's the first thing we need to classify. And the other one is like the sentiments like sarcasm and mockery.
Yes, sir. Another example, if there is a hashtag which somehow supports a decision a government has made, and there are some tweets from people which say, yeah, this government is the best and always takes the best decisions. So clearly we know that this is a sarcastic comment and the intent of the user isn't appraising the decision or the government, but to criticize it. So our model is still unable to understand that this is the intent of the user is not what it looks like. So this is another problem which we'll be facing while implementing the system.
Okay, thanks everyone. Take care then, bye.
Thank you, sir.